Lord, your word tells us that you have given to your church some to be pastors, some to be teachers, some to be prophets, evangelists. These are gifts from you. We thank you for the gift in Pastor Mulandi and his family, the way you have been using them and you are using them here in Nairobi Baptist Church. And even today, O Lord, we commit him to you, that you continue to use him among us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Bwana asifiwe. Praise the Lord. Are you well? Because we have many visitors, and because I just love to introduce my wife. Can I do that in just a minute? My wife is here, Levina Munengi Mulandi. She fell in love with her husband and dropped all her names and only kept Levina and took up all of mine. Are you well, Levina? Yes, she's there. Please welcome her. This is her regular service. I think, are our children in this service? I think they might be at Jiwe, the service across there. Worship Team Opinion Company, thank you very much for leading us very well. The Lord bless you. And Pastor, our senior pastor, thank you very much for this invitation to share from God's Word. Have you enjoyed these months of having this gentleman as our senior pastor? We thank God for you, and we are not shy to say it when we're in your presence, because we know your walk with God, it doesn't go to your head, it goes to the glory of God. But we really enjoy you being here. And may the Lord bless you and your good family. Pastor Gabriel, thank you for that introduction. Sometimes you're introduced and you're waiting for the person who was so glamorously introduced to appear. Then you realize it is you. And then you say, surely I'm a work in progress. Amen. We bring you glory, Lord, as we honor you. We bring you glory, Lord, as we honor you. You are wonderful. You are worthy, O Lord. You are worthy. I don't know if he's been wonderful to you. I don't know. I don't know what things you can say about him. We bring you glory, Lord, as we honor you. We bring you glory, Lord, as we honor you. You are wonderful. You are worthy, O Lord. You are wonderful. You are. Ni nani kama wewe, Baba? Kama wewe Masia, ni nani? Kama wewe Mwokozi, ni nani? Kama wewe Mulinzi. Na tunasema Alfa Omega, unanijali mimi, ewe Baba. Our Father and our God, you are wonderful. There is none like you. Your mercies are new every morning. When we think of the majestic throne that you sit on, with the emerald rainbow behind you, with the full color mix of your brilliance, O Lord, and the 24 elders following the living creatures, bowing before you, casting their golden crowns before you, O Lord, we join them and say, worthy, worthy, worthy are you, O Lord. And we thank you for your word this morning, as we take some time to learn from you. We know that your word does not depart from you, come to us and return to you void, but it accomplishes the purposes for which you set it out. We thank you that your word is sharper than a double-edged sword, and we know that even a brief interaction with your word is life-changing to us. And this is our sincere commitment. And to that end, Lord, I plead, Lord, that you would eclipse me, yet may it please you to use me, to speak through me for your glory, in Jesus' name. Amen. It's been about 7 years that I have been away from Nairobi Baptist Church. For those of you who are visitors, I was a full-time pastor in this church. And these 7 years, I have been in different institutions that have recognized that my background is pastoral. But because many of them are marketplace organizations, and sometimes they look at what I studied in my first, my undergraduate, somehow consistently, without consulting each other, these organizations have always had something in my portfolio that has to do with fraud investigations, that has to do with things accounting. And many of you can tell, even just from looking at me, that's not my area of gifting. But that has been my work for 7 years. And I have kind of learnt on the job, been trying to read here and there. And recently somebody was tutoring me on what is known as the fraud triangle. Many of you, of course, are very familiar with these things. So allow me just to share with those who don't come from a finance background. The fraud triangle, I'm going to try and make it sound complicated so that you're impressed by the things I've been doing for 7 years, but really, it's a very simple thing. If you go to the website of the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners, you will find this fraud triangle explained, and I've seen it work over and over again these 7 years. I am told by those wiser than me that a gentleman, Donald Cressy, is the one who really promoted this particular view, this philosophy, this thinking of the fraud triangle. He's written a book called Other People's Money. That's an interesting title. I think all Kenyans should read it. I have opinions of those who need to read it more than others, but that's not in the topic for today. Today is Mrs. Potiphar. And so they identify these three things, these three points that make a triangle, the fraud triangle. And they say that any of these is the right environment for fraud. One, if there is a need. If you have a cashier, a bazaar, you know, somebody in the front office handling money, and they have a need, it is likely that they will steal that money that you've entrusted to them. The first point of the triangle is need. When they have a need that is overwhelming them, that they cannot share with anybody else, and here is money, liquid cash, it becomes very hard because they have a need and the money is here. Sometimes it begins by saying, I will borrow and return, but we all know that story. Fraud begins by this overwhelming need that they don't think I can save, I can borrow, I can. The need is so overwhelming that one of the things that they consider is stealing that money. The need. Tuko pamoja lakini? You're rather quiet on me today. Mpo. Number two in the fraud triangle is the rationalization. The rationalization. And so you have put somebody in charge of some money, and they are entertaining the kind of thoughts, these kind of thoughts are floating around their minds. These people, they don't even treat me well. I deserve better than this. I make millions for them and they pay me peanuts. Once your mind is filled with such thoughts and there is money there, it becomes easy to appropriate that money with a clean conscience, sanitized, because you have rationalized that I deserve this. This, I brought it in anyway. If I take away some, you know, so you rationalize. The third one is the opportunity. And so, if this person who's in charge of money, I'm not saying you, there's those people, those other ones who we put in charge of money. If the opportunity presents itself and cash money is there, and you have very few checks and balances, very few structures, maybe it's an accounting office, and this one person is the one who initiates transactions, is the one who signs checks, is the one who approves, you know, one part they sign, another part they initial. It becomes, the opportunity is always there for them to steal this money. But this is what the fraud triangle theory says. If any one of these is in its right place, it is likely that fraud will happen. If all three converge, it is fairly impossible for fraud not to happen. If the need is there, somebody is there sitting and thinking, "Oi, I have a medical bill. My mother is in hospital." I don't know why these stories never have, "My father is in hospital." What's this with mothers? Even Mother's Day is so big. When is this fathers is a topic for another day. But, you know, my mother is in hospital. I have this money. They don't even deserve this money. You begin to rationalize. There's the need, then there's the rationalization. Anyway, this money is what they use for lunch. So if I take it, all they'll miss is a meal. But for me, it's a matter of life and death. And then there's the opportunity. Accounts that are done every 5 years. Reconciliation that is done every 5 years. Bank records that are checked every 5 years. Then it gives them an opportunity for fraud. I'd like you to write those 3 points, if you don't mind. Because I'd like to suggest to us today that if these 3 points of the fraud triangle, if they guarantee that fraud will happen fairly close to 100% financially, then when we look at the story of Joseph and Mrs. Potiphar, I think we can identify all three. And I want to suggest to us, if all these three happen, then it's fairly close that there'll be sexual fraud. There'll be immorality of this same kind that we see here. And so first, the need. When we read this story of Joseph and Mrs. Potiphar, I'm sorry we are not given her first name, but Mrs. Potiphar, we are able to identify some sexual needs that are there. And these sexual needs are overwhelming to the people that are concerned. I know that Joseph, in this story, is more the victim, but I want to suggest to you that he must also have had some need. Between verse 1 and verse 10, we are told several things about Joseph. Number one, he was a lonely young man. If we've been reading from the book of Genesis from the beginning, we know that this is the favorite son of his father, Jacob. And here he is in Egypt without the presence of his father, who was always, you know, looking out for his best, the one who gave him the multicolored dream coat. How would you feel if you are a teenager and your father, you know, who loved you so much, was not there? When I was 13, I went, I was in Form 1, and my sisters came to visit me in school, and they came driving daddy's car. Can you imagine? That's crime. In fact, I began praying for them, "Oh Lord, help daddy to forgive them." Then they told me, "Daddy is not well," which was just, you know, an introduction to, "Your dad has passed away." So we went for the funeral and everything, and people, when the news was broken to me that dad has died, I'll be honest, I didn't cry. How could I cry? Remember, My father was the Superman who used to walk, you know, 80 kilometers to school and 80 kilometers back every day without shoes. My father was the same one who was number one in all his classes, just like your father. And my father could beat your father, although there was never any match. And so when they told me he's dead, I could not believe. It didn't dawn on me until they lowered his body. And I thought, this is real. And I was 13, I was not a child. This is real. And sudden loneliness hit me that I don't know why I felt like an orphan. And mom was there. And in our family, we are not where two or three are gathered. We are many. You know, there was, but a sudden loneliness hit me. How did Joseph feel when he was so far from his father and didn't know how his father was doing, when he was in so much trouble? He was not on holiday on the Nile. No, he was a slave. And remember how he became a slave? His own siblings had sold him. Can you imagine the amount of loneliness that must have overwhelmed this young man? And then female company comes in. Don't you ever be lonely. That is recipe for the first point of fraud, sexual fraud, the need. You can imagine you have nobody in this world. Everything has gone wrong. You're beginning again. You're a teenager. And then somebody, okay, I submit to you, she wasn't that seductive. She was very straightforward. Come to bed with me. I'm thinking, I mean, there are better ways to put it, but anyway. But there were also other things that he must have been going through. Verse 6 to 7 tells us he was young and sexually vulnerable. In fact, this is what attracted Mrs. Potiphar to him. I don't know if you read in the news about this particular boys' school upcountry, where the boys walked 6 kilometers in torrential rain in a rainforest environment to visit a girls' school in the night. The girls' school has watchmen. It also has barbed wire. I'll just be honest with you. I have been a sexual sinner before. 6 kilometers, you're asking for too much. The girls SMS'd. And that's all the boys needed to be motivated to go. But the kind of music that we are feeding our children, the kind of things they are watching on the internet, why are we so surprised that boys would walk in the night? If I hear a sound in our house in the night, I tell my wife, come, let's pray. He is able. These boys were not about prayer. They went out into the night, walked 6 kilometers in the rain, knowing their watchmen, barbed wire, etc., sexual pressure. That's the age Joseph was in. But like I said before, we are not told too much about his sexual needs. The person whose sexual needs we are told is Mrs. Potiphar. Verse 6 to 7 tells us, she saw his physique. He looked a little like me when Levina married me. Things have changed, baby. You know, for many years I've had a complex about being overweight and extra obese. And one time, I think it was like the second year of our marriage, my wife told me, this is nonsense, you know? I like you just the way you are. When you hug me, I don't feel like some wind has just blown. I feel engulfed, surrounded, you know? So those of you who are praying that I lose weight, Shikilia. But Mrs. Potiphar looks at this young man, verse 7, 6 and 7 tells us, well-built and handsome, and she takes notice of him. And she invites him to bed, and the invitation is not very, very, you know, diplomatic. Come to bed with me. Verse 10 tells us that she does not give up because she does this daily. Every day she invited him. Every day, verse 10 tells us, she spoke to him. Verse 12 tells us, things got out of hand. And she says, come. come to bed with me. And she tries to, you know, to do this forcefully and is only able to grab the cloak as he runs away. What kind of sexual needs are these that would drive somebody to this extent? Somebody so sophisticated in society, etc. Now, be honest that I can't say much about this because I've never been a lady for any significant amount of time. I've done one or two drama play here, there, but nothing to really get into understanding this. But I do know that there was tremendous need. Different people have speculated what was happening in this particular home. And you know, when many people think about our topic is, you know, winning this, the purity war. When many people think about winning the purity war, they think this is a message for those in the other sanctuary, the younger people who are, you know, laden with lust. Lust is following them all over. You know, help them. Cast it in Jesus' name. But it's happening among our fathers and among our mothers. It's happening among married people. And here is an example. Different Bible commentators have speculated as to what was happening in this particular home. For example, I find it interesting that Potiphar was very angry. And I don't advocate for domestic violence, but I don't see him in an attempt to strangle Joseph. We're told he's very angry. And then he sends him to prison. And I think that's a good thing. But then as I read, I get uncomfortable. He sends him to prison where the king's prisoners were kept. So is that the place where when the king is that committee maximum prison? When I read chapter 40, I find perhaps this prison that the cupbearer and the baker were sent to is a kind of halfway house, some kind of remand, some kind of thing that, like at industrial area where they have VIP quarters. You know, he was angry indeed. But why send them to this kind of halfway house remand kind of thing? Because the king in chapter 40 sends his two servants there as he decides what their fate will be. But if Joseph had committed this particular sin that he was being accused of, then the king should have been angry and the sentence should have been given immediately. There was no need for him to go to a prison where he would behave well, be put in charge, and after that, you know, become the prince of Egypt. No. Speculate with me, even if it's just for a moment. Could it be that there was something wrong at home? I leave that to you. There was a need. It is obvious that there is a need by the amount of passion she's pursuing this Joseph every day with. It's a passion that is sustained. And we're beginning to see the triangle of fraud. There was need. I don't know, but for me, a day hardly goes before I have had an inappropriate series of inappropriate sexual thoughts. I know it's different for you guys. I'm just confessing my own sins. And sometimes I wonder, you know, what will happen? And then I'm reminded what we were told when we were young people in that particular sanctuary. And this is what we were told. You cannot keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can keep them from making a nest on your head. Bwana asifiwe. And that has helped me. Because every waking moment, there are evil thoughts, not only of killing and murder, but, you know, sometimes you get angry. But I'm saying, I'm just limiting myself to sexual thoughts and sexual sin. And it's crisscrossing over your mind, But that need, God can give strength over it if you take responsibility over that need. I remember when I was Joseph's age, my parents, my mom had gone out of the country for just about a month. And I was left in charge of, we have a ranch in Athi River, and so I was left in charge of this particular ranch, fairly close to what Joseph was going through. And then there was no electricity at that time, and so one of the ladies who worked there wrote me a note, and she had just, you know, become spiritually interested in the things of God. I was a new believer, and she wrote me this note, and I thought, she must be sharing a verse to encourage me. So I went and read it now, just before the generator electricity was put off, you know, just as the light is going off. It says something fairly inappropriate, but I'll try and summarize it and quote it in words that are a little kosher. My body is unwell. Only you can make me well. Then she said something like Potiphar's wife, and then she said, we can confess afterward. You know, we are kidding ourselves if we are not willing to own up that sexual needs and sexual, you know, things to excite us sexually are all over us. Many times we feel like either we're in a Joseph situation where we're being surrounded by all these opportunities, and they are not just opportunities, people pursuing us. And sometimes we're in Miss Potiphar's shoes where we have these overwhelming needs. That story has a good ending, because despite where God had taken me from, I was able to have the grace of God to tear up that note and not visit anyone that evening. You can't keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can keep them from making a nest. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. So the fraud triangle says that the first corner is there a need? And if you and I are going to get into the theme of what God is doing at Nairobi Baptist Church, if we're going to be able to catch the wave this family month, it's going to take some radical things for you and I to do in identifying this need and taking the kind of steps that Joseph took. It's going to take seeing that there are birds flying all over, but covering our heads that no nest is made. Indeed, that blood of Jesus is powerful and is able to cleanse us, but it is our responsibility before God to make sure that these birds do not nest, that we do not allow that need to be overwhelming. Point number two, the rationalization. We said when it comes to financial fraud, one of the first things is the need, that somebody has a financial need and money is here. But the second thing is that they allow some certain thoughts that begin to confuse them that it's okay. The fact that I need this money, you know, it kind of gives me the right. I feel a sense of entitlement to this money. And so taking it ceases to be a wrong thing. It ceases to be sin. And this is what happened to Mrs. Potiphar. First, I suggest to you an argument from silence. Verse 7 to verse 10. But really from verse 1 to verse 23, there is no word of Mr. Potiphar. His absence, his silence is deafening, perhaps too loud. And then the commentary that is given of how he trusted Joseph, that he was in charge of everything, he's delegated everything to Joseph, only concerned himself with the food that he ate. And Joseph has a testimony when she tells him, come to bed with me, and says, you know, he has withheld nothing in this house from me. I am, you know, the CEO only with regard to you. But I wonder, had he delegated intimacy with her? Had he absconded his responsibility? Was he overwhelmed by his high office and duty, frequent foreign travel, fatigue, etc., ad infinitum, ad nauseam? Because when you see the passion with which she pursues Joseph, when you see the length of time that she's pursuing Joseph day after day, you have to realize there was something at home that was not okay. But you see, something at home that is not okay is no excuse to sin. But sometimes this is the beginning point of rationalization. It wouldn't be far speculation to imagine Mrs. Potiphar saying, Kweni, what is wrong? I deserve. He is a slave. I am in need. He is attractive. Kwani, I'm just supposed to stay like this, like a corpse. How am I supposed to survive? A fly girl like me, you know, she must have rationalized in her mind that I have this need and it is legitimate. Whichever way it is fulfilled, it's okay. Why didn't she reason like Joseph? Why did she rationalize instead of reasoning like Joseph? Joseph says, with me in charge, he's left everything. Why would I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? But that's not how Mrs. Potiphar saw it. She saw it as a right. She had burned her conscience with a hot iron. She rationalized that she was not getting love, or she needed more love. We are not given much commentary about that. And it becomes okay in her mind. Long before you open the money drawer and take the money, in your mind, when you're still at home and you rationalize that, I deserve that money, I am entitled to that money, how you take it is just a method. It's just a function of methodology. It's already rationalized in your mind. You've already cleared your mind and put, you know, everything okay to be able to do this. And this is what happens to Mrs. Potiphar. How else would you, you know, be able to explain such irrational behavior? Look at her place in society, and this is a slave. And, you know, she's telling him every day after day, come to bed with me. She's not even hinting. There are those, now, I have nothing against ladies dressing. This is not a comment on ladies dressing. But there are some who wear those dresses with a desire to tell young Joseph, come to bed with me. Somebody might wear Windows 95, Windows 98, or full Vista. Not Mrs. Potiphar. She was not even in Windows 10. She was telling him live, come to bed with me. And when he wasn't getting this, although it was not a hint, she went ahead and grabbed him. Why? Because in her mind, those actions were not wrong. Why? Because she deserved a little TLC, tender, loving care. You see, when you and I cease to realize that these bodies of ours and our sexual systems are gifts that God has given us, then we can rationalize immorality left, right, and center. This lady, her conscience had been so treated that she saw nothing wrong. That when she lied, she did it as in she did not break a sweat. He came here to make sport. Hockey, volleyball, netball. What sport are you talking about? That's how treated her conscience was. Why? Because she had rationalized it. She had said in her mind, it's okay. I have this sexual need, and it has to be fulfilled. And this is the guy to fulfill it. Don't worry, there's no danger of HIV and AIDS. Don't worry, there's no danger of unwanted pregnancy. Don't worry about being caught. We're in the house. You know, I deserve this. Small wonder she could go to this extent. Come to bed with me. I want to give a small aside, if I may. That sometimes when we think of sexual sin, many of us who are a little older think of sexual sin as adultery, you know, fornication, sleeping with, going outside of your marriage. But I'd like to suggest to you that according to the Bible in Corinthians, part of faithfulness in marriage is keeping your marriage vows and being faithful to your wife, but also being sexually active with your spouse. I'm not justifying the rationalization Mrs. Potiphar had in her mind. But many times, we married people give our weaker partners an opportunity. And I'm not saying this to justify anybody who is, you know, acting Mrs. Potiphar, or whether you're male or female, you can do Mrs. Potiphar. No. But when I read 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 3 to 5, the husband should fulfill his marital duty to his wife, and likewise the wife to her husband. The wife's body does not belong to her alone. This is a verse that I like quoting to my wife frequently. Gentlemen, please memorize it. The wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband. In the same way, the husband's body does not belong to him alone, amen, ladies, but also to his wife. Do not deprive each other except by mutual consent and for a time. It is limited. Then come together again so that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Now, Pastor, these verses are too heavy for a young man like me to explain what they are saying. So may the Holy Spirit help us. But basically what this verse is saying to you, Mr. Potiphar, or if you are like this, Madam, is that this whole thing of, oh, I have a headache, is not there. I'm asking, is it there? It says for prayer, and that for a short while, come together quickly because of Satan. So all this reason that, oh, you know, because we had an argument, therefore we can deprive one another. It's not there. He says, do not deprive one another. You don't need a PhD in English to understand what do not deprive means. I am feeling tired. It's not there. Allow me to read it one more time since I can't explain it. Do not deprive each other except by mutual consent. So the fact that you are pontificating and saying, I don't feel like, that's okay. Don't worry. In fact, just stay not feeling like. But that is no right to deprive one another. And I'm saying this because peradventure it could be the situation that Mrs. Potiphar was in. And I'm not saying that in justification of her actions. She needs to take responsibility for her rationalization. That I deserve this. I need to be treated better. My husband is not there, perhaps. Come to bed with me. It is not right. Why? Because God says it is not right. For me, I find it very hard to understand how loving God is. Let me tell you one of my struggles, especially as a new believer, but I'm not sure it's really over, was how can a holy God allow a husband and a wife to enjoy something so much? It almost seems like it's bad. It almost feels like something that you must do, and after you do, you confess, sorry that we did it. It gave us a daughter, we thank you, but you know. But it isn't. I do not understand God to the extent that I can explain that to us, but he does say that we have a responsibility to one another in that fashion. And that we should not get to a point of rationalizing like Mrs. Potiphar did. My last point is the opportunity. And so you have this cashier, and the cashier has a need. And the need is, you know, an overwhelming financial need. And then they begin to rationalize. You know, there is money here. It's not even going to be used for 30 days. Whether I bank it today or I bank it, you know, a month from now, it's not going to make a difference to these people. And anyway, they pay me peanuts. And anyway, they even forgot that I was supposed to bring change of this money. And I am treated so badly in this, you know, in this place where I'm employed. It's okay. In fact, I deserve better. And then you take the money because the need is there. And the rationalization is, you know, straightforward and gives you opportunity to go. But the third part of the triangle is when the opportunity opens up. When there is a small gap and there's poor accounting system, there's no accountability, then the cashier has now completed the triangle. Close to 100% fraud will definitely happen. And this is what happens to this lady. She sees Joseph, he is handsome, he's good looking, and it conjures some need with her. She began to take notice of him. And then she told him, come to bed with me. And he refuses. And then she goes ahead and every day, we're told day after day, she spoke to him about this. She said, come to bed with me. And he said, no, I cannot do this. You know, it is wicked and sin before God. I cannot disappoint my master in this way. But she is persistent. And one day while he is in the house, doing his normal duties, she grabs him by force. Come to bed with me. And he runs out and leaves the cloak. I have some questions here that I'm still debating in my head. Joseph, if you were in charge of all the workers, in the house, you are the one who is responsible for everything. If you are going to work in the house, why didn't you tell one of the workers, I am going to wipe tables. Come wipe with me. Because you are in charge. It's not abuse of office. But you know, to be honest, the Bible doesn't tell us he made a mistake. In fact, verse 10 tells us, although she spoke to Joseph day after day, he refused to go to bed with her or even to be with her. The Bible seems to suggest that he did everything to deny opportunity for this to happen. And we cannot speculate how they end up in this situation, but it seems to me that he had taken care of all, you know, possibilities, but this one time he just got trapped. And for her, it was an opportunity. They were in the house. One day he went to the house. For today, it would be in the car or in the matatu, school manyanga or something. And none of the servants were inside. And she took opportunity and grabbed him. And this is the biggest challenge that we have today. Because as married people, we may be very careful about the need. We may be very careful about rationalizing. And we may know it is sin and I will not do this. But we are not too careful about making boundaries, putting passwords that even if we wanted, we wouldn't fall into sexual sin. I don't know if we are together. When it comes to passwords, some years ago, it was okay to put your spouse's name. Password Levina, you know, or date of birth, you know. But these days, even the free websites, even the free emails, they ask for alphanumeric password with at least 8 characters, some of which must be symbols, just to safeguard your emails. Recently, a friend of mine got an email from me asking for 320,000 naira. Part of our work in International Bible Society, Biblica, is translating the Bible into Hausa and other languages. And so I travel there frequently. And so when my friends got this, they knew he is stuck somewhere, perhaps, you know, in Kano, and needs some naira. We need to have a fundraising and send him some money, you know, right now. And one just got to me on WhatsApp and says, now, I don't have 320,000 naira. Can I send you 20? You know, or thereabouts. somebody had hacked into my email. Is your life hack-free? Have you secured your sexual purity with such boundaries, with such passwords, that it's impossible for people to come in? You see, the passwords, the opportunities that were there at this time was Joseph and Mrs. Potiphar were in the house, not a very good geographical location. And secondly, they were alone. When I was in my late teens, I had been preaching somewhere and a lady called me. You need to remember, these are the days when I was taller, darker, and slimmer. And she was calling me to tell me how she enjoyed my ministry. And if I'm to give you the text, unadulterated, it was, "Thank you. You really have a gift of preaching." But this is how it went. First, it came at 9 p.m. Then it went something like this. "Oh, Pastor, thank you. You're preaching." I knew it had very little to do with preaching. I knew what was being looked for here was an opportunity. And again, by God's grace, he delivered me. What boundaries do you have? I have very upcountry Ushago boundaries. For example, I don't pick ladies' calls after 9 p.m. Please, if somebody is in an emergency, just call Levina. Because I am weak. I am not one of those strong men who can counsel you at midnight. It will give opportunity. The other thing that I don't do, and I'm not asking anybody to observe this, I'm just sharing from my weakness, I don't give people of the opposite gender a ride after 6 p.m. In this Kenya. Yes. And that's why, by God's grace, the years that we served here as youth pastors to your children, you never heard of any of them coming home with a child with a head shaped like this. It's not because I'm strong. It's some of these Ushago things that helped. Let me tell you, one of these youth was so frequent in our house, and she used to babysit for us, our children. And so maybe Levina and I, my wife, have been traveling, and then we arrive, and my wife usually after traveling, says, "Oh, I'm so tired." Some of you have experienced that, yeah? You're the one driving, but the spouse is the one who's tired. Why don't you drop her at home? Let me just share with you my foolishness of what I would do. We lived in Golf Course. Pastor Majid lived in Lavington. I would drive to Lavington, pick him, come pick this lady from our house, drop her across the bridge of South Sea, come back, drop Pastor Majid at his house in Lavington, and then come to my Ngumo house. And let me tell you, fuel was not reimbursable those days. But that lady today is married to a good friend of mine. And when she comes and hugs me, he has no evil thought of, "Who are you? This Pastor Mulandi, he is related to Mrs. Potiphar." Why? Because the opportunity was denied. "Joseph, what are you doing with Mrs. Potiphar in the same house alone?" What boundaries do you have that even if you change your mind and wanted to do something immoral, that the boundaries, the opportunities are so closed up, the password is so strong that it cannot happen? You see, evil people can be very patient. When you look at the story of Mrs. Potiphar, after the first day she said no, he said no, second day he said no, she didn't give up and say, "Uyo." You know? No. She kept at it. And I don't know if you realize that the devil is behind the demon of lust. And I want to say something today, and hear this young preacher. The year is coming to an end. We just have about 3 or 4 months. And we've been saying as a church, we need to catch the wave. But that wave needs to be caught also at the family level. And this is why we are taking the month of August to ask ourselves family questions. What boundaries do you have that will safeguard your purity? That will keep you on the winning path? I want to close with a verse from Romans 16, verse 20, that the Lord put on my mind as I prepared for today. And it says, "And the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet." Winning the purity walk is possible because of the grace of God. But there are many of us who need to take a stand. And I don't know how to conduct a time of prayer for us this morning. Our time is long gone. I don't know whether to ask you to stand with me. I don't know whether to invite you to come and stand in front here and tell God to put a fence and for you to dismantle this satanic triangle of sexual impurity, of sexual fraud. I don't know. Sometimes we want to preserve your and my dignity. But tomorrow when the newspapers are splashed with CEO and his PA found in compromising situation, how will we protect your identity in that kind of situation? Why don't we come before the Lord? In my language, we have a story that we've adopted. I don't know if you know the word for a pin in your mother tongue. In my mother tongue, it's called kabini. But when we're in Nairobi, we say kavini. Did you hear the story of this man who bought a house? And the person he bought the house for, it was a bargain. You know these masons that you just find and you're like, this is a bargain. And you just empty all your resources and those of your friends and buy this great house. And this house was going for such a cheap price that this guy just went for it. But the guy who was selling it, the vendor said, all I need to keep in this house is this peg, kavini. I just want to keep this kavini in this house. This kavini will be the only thing that belongs to me. The whole house is yours. The guy said, Reke Marie, bring it on. So he bought this house. And after a few months, the vendor who had sold the house came to his kavini and began to put, you know, very smelly clothes there, some decomposing, you know, animal tripe, intestines and so on, as they were decomposing, and he could not live in that house. But you know, he couldn't go legal because the papers said, the house is yours, all is mine is kavini. And indeed, the man was only using, I don't know, where have you gone silent with me? Kavini. And many of us have yielded our lives. But there's still that sexual kavini that we've left there. And Satan has been harassing us. We are trying to catch the wave, but we are always losing the grip to put the sail in the right way for God to take us to a new level. And it's just because of what? Kavini. I wonder how many of you, if you could join me, please, are praying and asking the Lord, I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee, just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus, this my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord.
closer walk with Thee. Grant it, Jesus, this my plea. Daily walking close to Thee, let it be. Dear Lord, let it be.
We are bringing this service to a close. And there are moments when we have to choose between our dignity and our deliverance. When we've got to come to the Lord and say, Lord, I don't want to go on this way anymore. There are moments when we have to come before the Lord and say, Lord, I know areas where I have faltered. I know areas where I have sinned, where I have blown it. And I'm coming to you, Lord. Take over. If that's the case, I want you to pick your personal effects. I want you just to walk in front here where Pastor Mulandi is standing. I just want you to come and stand with us here. We are going to pray together. Just pick your personal effect. You're saying, yes, there is an area that I'm struggling in. It doesn't show you are being embarrassed or being unnecessarily exposed. We are being honest and sincere before the Lord. So if there is a situation, there is an issue and a struggle somewhere and something that you're saying, yes, I want the Lord to just work in my heart, pick up your personal effects. Just come here over the next 3 minutes. We are bringing the service to a close. If you just pick up your personal effects as we sing that chorus one more time, join us here.
Just a closer walk with Thee. Grant it, Jesus, this my plea.
Are you honest with yourself? Are you sincere? God is speaking to your heart. Come, come.
Walking close to Thee. Let it be.
Keep on coming, keep on coming.
Dear Lord, let it be.
Keep on coming, we're waiting for you. Just come. From upstairs, the Lord is speaking to your heart. I want you to come. I want you to come. No undue pressure, no need to embarrass you or unnecessarily expose you. We just want to be sincere with God. Are you sincere? Are you honest? Keep on coming. Keep on coming.
Daily walking close to Thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Our Father and our God, we humbly bow our heads before your eternal presence. In our weaknesses, we are not even worthy to look up into your face, O God Almighty, because of the struggles that we go through in our lives. You know the challenges we face. You know those moments, Lord, when our needs have driven us to rationalize and compromise the standards that you have put up for us. You know those moments when we have grabbed the opportunities that have come our way to blow away, oh God, the righteousness that you have called us to live. Father, you know those moments when we are struggling as couples, as married individuals with one another, and times when we have compromised in our thoughts, in our actions, virtually, and given ourselves over to things that we should not even watch or attend to. You know those moments, Lord, when we have struggled and we have failed, we have fallen. And yet you are a merciful God who reaches out to the fallen and handpicks us and brings us up again and puts our feet on solid ground that we may walk again with you. And so we thank you that you have not forsaken nor abandoned us. And for these that have taken the bold step to come before your holy presence, Father God, we thank you. We thank you for each and every one of them. It is our prayer that they would experience the liberty, the deliverance, the freedom that comes about when individuals come to God and say, Lord, we are weak, help us in our weaknesses. And we pray that the Spirit of the living God would take hold of each and every one of them and would begin to lift them up and give them strength and ability to be overcomers, that no longer would they succumb to the trials and the temptations of the evil one. Where there is a need for deep forgiveness, Lord, forgive them and give them that sense of having been forgiven. May you be honored and may you be glorified.